Hi, I'm Laura Mucha, and in this new UNICEF series, we're speaking to a range of world-leading experts to explore childhood adversity, mental health and well-being, and love. We'll explore questions like, what can we do to protect and improve young people's mental health? How does adversity impact us as children and the adults we become? Why are safe and loving relationships so important to us growing up? In this episode, we're going to focus in on the importance of safe and loving relationships and what that means. And our guest is Dr. Daniel Siegel, internationally acclaimed author, award-winning educator, and child psychiatrist. Welcome, Dan.
Thanks, Laura. Thanks for having me here. It's really an honor to be here and with UNICEF, talking about love from a scientific point of view and how it helps people. Wouldn't want to be anywhere else.
I wanted to begin with the question, which is, why is love so important in childhood?
Well, you know, love is a word that people use in different ways. As a scientist, in many ways, we're asked not to talk about love. As a physician trained in medicine, I was asked not to talk about love, really. And then as an educator, it sometimes feels awkward because people think you mean romantic love and all that goes along with that. And so when we use love in a very specific way about romance, you know, you can understand, all right, it's for your private life. But actually, when you look at child development, the vital force of life that we call love, just to define it that way, the vital force of life is the essence of what actually helps the child grow and thrive. And so what I've been fascinated with as a scientist is how you can study the nature of relationships and what does love have to do with not just how we communicate with each other with that vital force of life, but also how it affects the way the brain in your head and in fact the brain that's distributed throughout the whole body. So I call it the embodied brain, how it all gets put together. It's different parts linked together.
I really love that you brought up the brain. I think sometimes people can be a bit cynical when you mention the word love. As you've said, they're a little bit like, whoa, how do we measure that? And I wondered if you could talk a little bit about what we know about the way that love impacts the brain, both in early childhood and adolescence and later.
Yeah, well, you know, there's a wonderful legacy that started in London, really, with two people, John Bowlby and Mary Ainsworth, who from a scientific perspective were exploring, I think, what many cultures for thousands and thousands of years have known, is that the way we connect with our kids actually affects how they grow and develop. And the formal way of studying that is in a field called attachment research. So in that field, what Bowlby and Ainsworth did together was to say, what can we understand about this communication, the relationship between the caregiver? And it's more than one caregiver, it's not just the mother. It's, as Sarah Hurdy, HRDY, the anthropologist, talks about, it's mothers and others. And that we have this thing called alloparenting in our human species. Unlike other mammals who have attachment, we have one of the only species who have several different caregivers that take care of the young child, young infant. So what we see in those different attachment figures is that they are bringing their specific way of connecting with a child that has the basically the three elements of this. The parent or other caregiver senses what's going on inside the child. So they perceive the mind beneath the behavior. And that would be like feelings or needs or drives. And then the second thing they do besides sensing that is make sense of it. So, oh, I think you're hungry, Laura, or I think you're lonely, you need a hug, or I think you're frightened, you need me to help protect you. And the third thing is then I take what I perceive, number one, what I sense, number two, and now I take action to actually provide, in a sense, safety for you, or a way that you're seen, or a way that you can feel soothed if you're distressed. And those S's basically form a fourth S, you're secure. So if you're safe, seen, meaning your inner experience is known beyond your outer behavior, and you're soothed, meaning you're distressed, and then you're able to feel better, then you have an overall feeling of security, which Ainsworth and Bowlby beautifully talked about, studied, and that's the research area I was trained in. was to look at what are the elements of that kind of communication, which is basically taking apart the details of what it means to be in a loving attachment relationship.
It's really interesting that you've talked about alloparenting, because I often think of this as a parent myself, and having read a lot about attachment theory, this idea that it's quite demanding providing the circumstances for a secure bond with your child. And it can be especially demanding for those growing up in war zones or in abusive relationships or in extreme poverty. And so this idea, I often think about Hardy's point, is like, we weren't initially doing this in tiny little nuclear groups. We had the support of others. And do you think the answer is that we should all just start living in communities and everyone should share parenting? Because I would like that as a parent.
You know, the fastest answer is yes. We've lost that in modern culture, and it's not good for anyone, actually, to think that only the mother is the sole caregiver of this child. So if you have, you know, like we have dogs here in our home, and, you know, if we have a female dog who has pups, she doesn't let anybody else take care of those pups. It's her job. That's what she does as a dog. We raise mice and rats and all sorts of animals here. And, you know, that's the way they do it. The mother takes care of them and that's it. But humanity is different. And in many ways, our evolution as a species was shaped, Sarah Hurdy beautifully describes, by alloparenting, because we had to figure out who in our village can we trust. So we had to basically learn to sense their mind. I call that mind sight, to see their mind, so that when we come up to you, let's say we're two adults, and I go, where's Laura's attention? Where's her intention? Where's her awareness? Can I give this valuable baby to Laura while I go out and do stuff in the field or gather food? And for now, you're going to be taking care of the baby, or someone else, or vice versa. I might be the one to take care of the baby. And so what I have to do is I have to be able to know your mind. Well, that ability is very unique to humans in certain ways. And as it got elaborated, as our social systems became more complex, and the higher part of the brain shows that complexity, that we then use this mindsight ability to be collaborative and to live in just what you're describing, communities of care, where we're connecting with each other, where we're collaborating with each other, we're cooperating with each other. And in that compassionate way of communicating, you see love made visible, right? That's where the community is filled with love. If you take the word you mentioned that's so important earlier, adversity. Adversity would be challenges to all those things I just mentioned. So instead of being collaborative, there's harsh, destructive competition. Instead of being cooperative, where you're joining with people, there's disconnection and disillusionment, right? Instead of people being kind, there's harshness. And all these ways that you could take apart adversity, you could probably apply it to the S's too. You're not safe, you're not seen, and you're not soothed, and you're not secure, right? So in all those ways, there's an interesting, you know, parallel to get to a very simple thing of what love truly is. There's a process called integration where different things are linked together. So if you take a parent or other attachment figure and a child, when they're allowed to be different with different needs and then connected, we call that linkage of differentiated parts integration. So that's how we're defining that word. Secure attachment is based on integrative communication, where depending on the temperament of a child, a parent may respond differently because the temperamental needs are different. The temperament is a inborn proclivities or tendencies of the nervous system. So amazingly, relational integration is what love looks like in a parent-child relationships. And then when you see those relationships that allow a child to thrive, when we do studies of the brain, and this I review in all the different writings I do, but essentially integrated relationships are what love is. In the brain, it becomes integrated, where differentiated parts are linked. And it turns out that every kind of regulation, like regulating my emotions or my attention or my thought or my memory or my behavior or my relationships or even my morality, all those fall into the term self-regulation, which I don't like that term because the self isn't just in the body. But anyway, these regulatory capacities that allow a person to thrive in life are integrative functions of the brain. That is, literally, I could show you the anatomy if we wanted to do it, but where the different regions are allowed to be different, and then they're linked. So let's take trauma as one example. Developmental trauma, and you have two big forms, abuse on the one hand, neglect on the other. Both of them, their primary impact on the brain of the growing child is to have a poor development of integration in the brain. And I could name the corpus callosum that links the left and right, the hippocampus that's linking widely separated memory systems to each other, the prefrontal cortex here behind the forehead that links the top to the middle, to the bottom, to the body. And then even something called the connectome, where the whole brain is looked at and its differentiated areas can be studied and how they're linked together, either anatomically or functionally or both. And all of those regions I just mentioned are impaired in growth with the adversity of the extreme forms of abuse and neglect. And the negative impact on the child is they can't regulate themselves as they become a toddler and then go to school. And then what Alan Stroh has shown in his powerful longitudinal studies is you then evoke from the environment, from your dysregulation, dysregulated responses. So in a way, you are having this trouble regulating your internal world, so your relational world becomes dysregulated also, and that perpetuates the adversity, sadly.
I have been reading Stroh's work recently, at the weekend, in fact, and one of the things I think is amazing about it is that it's easy. If you start studies at preschool or afterwards, it's easy to think, oh, look, this child is resilient. Look, they have some innate quality that just was like magically ping, landed there. But what Stroh did with all his colleagues was look before that, before the children were born, and see actually where this begins, which is in love. And I do feel like sometimes that's misunderstood. And I wonder whether this idea of resilience just being like completely innate, whether it lingers on a bit.
Yeah, you know, it's so great you're saying that. I remember a few parenting books back when I had to deal with this issue, because there's a big push in some of the scientific community to say, oh, everything is genetic and resilience is just you're born with it or not. So I called up Alan Stroh, and I said, you know, I'm seeing these papers published and, you know, these arguments being presented. He goes, the studies absolutely show resilience comes from a relationship, even if it's one that's rare in your life, because your primary attachment figures were not so helpful or loving, you know. If you had one person, an aunt who visited a few times a year, a teacher, a caseworker who comes in, that was like a seed of hope, a seed of love that's there that can then blossom later on. And that's what Alan Stroh really, as you're pointing out, talks about relationships being the source of resilience. And so we need to, in these times of a lot of challenges with the pandemic, with the, you know, the way the environment is being destroyed, with the incredible political tensions that are here, we can go on and on. You know, parents should know that relationship, when the world is in turmoil, can still provide the resilience your child needs. And so we need to, of course, work on all those larger issues, no question about that. And parents and teachers need to know that the one-on-one relationship, the love that you give, will lead to integration of the child's whole bodily system, which then they will carry with them as this internal source of resilience. Doesn't mean we stop working on protecting the environment or ending racism or, you know, ending violence. We have to work to do that also. But from the inside out, a child is not reading the newspaper. A child is just having a connection with their attachment figures. And that's the empowerment we need to give anyone helping love be manifest within relationships. Because people might say, well, who cares about love in a relationship? Well, if you want something concrete, here's the concrete thing. When children have love in their relationships, where they're safe, where they're seen, where they're soothed, that security literally harnesses something called neuroplasticity. The growth of the brain will be affected by those three S's. And the fourth S, security, is basically an integrated brain. And so then you are better prepared to deal with the turmoil of the larger world when your relational world has been integrated, when it's been full of love.
You've talked a bit about security. I wondered if you could talk briefly about insecurity.
Yeah, well, the word insecurity is so interesting. You know, in the attachment research world, and I know we have colleagues together in that world, you know, we have used the term insecure because it was in contrast to secure attachment. The sad thing about using the word insecure is that it has a general meaning outside of the scientific field, like, oh, that person's insecure, and oh, poor person, you know, they should grow up, you know, and they should, you know, pull themselves up by the bootstraps, this kind of thing. So sadly, there's a lot of pushback on that term. So I try to use the term non-secure, because people go, what does that mean? I go, yeah, right, exactly. Thanks for asking. It's a specific category of attachment research where we have found some kids have secure relationships and some are non-secure. And so no one misinterprets that. So you'll hear me use that weird word, non-secure, instead of insecure. So I just want to start with that. So the formal term insecure attachment, which I'll call non-secure, refers to any of the three categories of patterns we've seen all around the world across cultures with thousands of studies with, you know, tens and tens of thousands of subjects studied and relationships studied. So this is not just for one country or another. This is all around the planet. You see these different categories expressed in different ways because every culture is different, but just to know that these are found universally. So what do we know about the non-secure versus the secure? In different countries, you'll see these percentages differently. So I'll just talk about the United States where I live, but the percentages might be a little different. In the United States, somewhere between 55 and 65% of the non-clinical population studied have secure attachment, which means that somewhere around about a third to a little under a half of children's primary relationship, because we do have a primary attachment figure and then other attachment figures. But when we study this, we study the one that the child's spending the most time with. So that primary attachment relationship is said to be non-secure, insecure. Now, the thing about that is to say that the child is never said to be insecure or non-secure, even though in quick speaking, even some researchers will say, oh, that's an insecure baby. No. The relationship of that baby to that caregiver is not secure. And in fact, that same baby with another caregiver, because we have multiple caregivers, could be secure. So you never, never, never say the baby is insecure, even though it rolls off the tongue sometimes by mistake that way. But every researcher knows you don't speak like that. So you say the relationship is insecure, or I'll say non-secure. So what are the three kinds of non-secure relationships? In the US, about 20% of the population, one out of five, their primary relationship is called avoidant. And this is where the caregiver is emotionally distant and essentially, yes, keeps the child safe. So that S is there, but doesn't really see the child. They don't really look at the feelings beneath the behavior, the inner subjective experience beneath outwardly manifested actions, right? So that's what we mean by the mind, is your subjective experience. That's one part of the mind. So the child isn't seen, and therefore they're not so easily soothed, because if you don't ask what's going on inside of my kid, how do you know how to actually soothe them? So the soothing and the seeing not so reliably there, and often not there, but the child is safe. And so their physical needs are taken care of, but not their inner, you can call them emotional needs. And that is developing an avoidant attachment. And that kind of relationship basically is emotionally distant. And a child's inner experience within that relationship is to be kind of disconnected, even from their own emotional life, because no one has talked to them about it. So that's one out of five. And when those kids tend to grow up, they develop a narrative, a story about their life, which is called dismissing. They basically say relationships are not important and the past didn't really affect me. What else do you want to know? You know, like this. And so that's 20% of the adult population too. Dismissing adult attachment has a correlation in two ways with the avoidant attachment. The if I'm a kid who's avoidantly attached to you, Laura, if someone did a narrative analysis of your what's called adult attachment interview, you would have a dismissing stance and I would have an avoidant attachment to you. So that's one group. The next group is about 15% in the United States, and that's called ambivalent attachment. And so instead of like avoiding you when you return in this paradigm we have that we study this in, I cling to you and I want to be with you, but I also want to be with the toys, but I want to be with you because what has happened in our relationship is that you've given me the experience of inconsistency. Sometimes I'm seen and sometimes I'm not. Sometimes I'm soothed and sometimes I'm not. I'm generally safe, but you know, I can't really rely on you because it's so inconsistent. And sometimes you intrude your emotions into my experience. So like, let's say I'm hungry and you're getting really anxious that you're not going to be a good mother and feed me well. Well, then your anxiety gets into me, but I was just hungry. But now, am I hungry or am I anxious? Who's you? Who's me? So the inner state of that relationship is confusion, not disconnection like the avoidantly attached child, but in this avoidant experience, I get disconnected. Here now, in the ambivalent experience, I'm confused. And when we study your adult attachment narrative, what I would generally lean towards developing is called a preoccupied, where I still have leftover garbage and think about the past, even though I'm an adult, and you know I should be like let that go. And then the third kind, which overlaps with the other three, secure would be, you know, basically where I am safe, reliably, and where repairs are made when the inevitable ruptures happen for any of these S's. You know, as Ed Tronick has beautifully shown, I'm seen, I'm soothed, and then I develop security. That's the 55 to 65%. Now in this group, which, you know, sadly about 20 years ago, the percentage I would have said was 5 to 15%, depending on the study, of what's called disorganized attachment. And now studies are showing it's somewhere closer to 30%. Yeah, and this is the most distressing because these kids have the experience basically of not being safe with their parents. They experience terror that's caused by the caregiver. And it leads to what's called fear without solution is what Mary Main and Eric Hesse have called it. It's kind of like a biological paradox. A deeper part of my brain says, I'm being threatened. I need to get away from the threat. But a little bit of a higher part of my networks, you know, their mammalian say, oh, I'm being threatened. I should go to my caregiver. My attachment figure will protect me. But if the attachment figure is the source of terror, my brain cannot resolve that. The deep brainstem system says, get away from that source of terror. The higher networks of attachment, the higher in the brain, go, oh, I'm terrorized, go towards that person. So one part of my brain says, go toward you. Another part of my brain says, go away from you. And I'm stuck. So I fragment. So I don't have a disconnected brain. I don't have a confused brain. I have a fragmented experience in that relationship. And sadly, the initial hypothesis was, okay, if you have disorganized attachment, probably if the baseline is secure, you're going to do fine in life. But actually, everybody, unless they get therapy or healing relationships of some sort, has significant trouble regulating their emotions, not just being, you know, ambivalent and, you know, preoccupied with the past, but literally fragmenting to the point of having a clinical condition called dissociation, which is a disassociation of usually associated processes, including consciousness. So you can fragment your sense of continuity across experiences. Your memory can be fragmented. You've disconnected from your body. You can dissociate in lots of different ways. And, you know, as a therapist, this finding, I remember being with Mary Main and Mary Ainsworth, in Virginia, where Mary Ainsworth was when I was learning all this stuff. And we had this 3-hour dinner just talking about the emerging ideas about dissociation. This was 1990. And that happened to be my clinical area of expertise. And now I was being trained as an attachment researcher. And now as a new finding, they were discovering that dissociation, at least one cause of it, there may be other causes, but one cause of it was disorganized attachment. That was like a mind-blowingly powerful finding, in addition to the finding, we should just say that the best predictor how any of these attachment categories emerge, disorganized, ambivalent, or avoidant, these non-secure forms, the best predictor is how the parent has made sense of their life. So a number of studies, including one by Mary Ainsworth, has shown that if you had loss or trauma yourself, but made sense of it, you resolved your loss, you resolved your trauma, and there's a way of assessing that with the adult attachment interview from Mary Main, then your child will not have disorganized attachment, for example. But if a parent was with unresolved loss or was with unresolved trauma, there was a very high likelihood that they would be inadvertently, unintentionally, usually unintentionally, terrifying their children and leading to disorganized attachment, which has a real challenge to regulating your emotions, to having a non-fragmented mind, and to having mutually rewarding relationships or thinking clearly under stress. So all those things are huge assaults on basically integrative functioning, integrative regulation, because if you have terror created by your caregiver that's not repaired, then the outcome is the most negative, disorganized attachment.
Thank you. That was a really good summary of some difficult ideas in a really, really overwhelmingly researched area. So thank you for putting it all so brilliantly and clearly. So when I think this through on my own, quietly in front of research in the dark London winters, I often find myself thinking, the problem is if, let's say, I grew up in the circumstances where I would have a disorganized attachment bond with whoever was responsible for bringing me up, for whatever reason. Maybe they grew up in war themselves, or they were abused, or whatever it is that has led them to that place. And I have this, and I'm going to have a child, or I'm going to be a teacher, or I'm going to, you know, work as a social worker. How do I overcome that? Because I feel like if what we want to do, if the end game is to try and provide the circumstances in society around the world where everyone can have access to a safe and loving family, or at least one person, then that means we need to help some people with difficult pasts process them. And that's not that easy, particularly in some countries where they have very limited mental health infrastructure. So what do we do?
Well, Laura, that's such an important question. So let me tease apart some of the really, I think, impactful elements of your question, one by one. So the first is to remind us all to take a deep breath and say that there is no such thing as perfect parenting. So even though Laura and I are discussing, you know, here are some of the things science has shown are really crucial for the development of the child and the brain, everyone gets all, you know, upset if the brain's not going to go right. No, take a deep breath and say there is no such thing as perfect parenting. There is being present as a parent. There's showing up as a parent. And no one gets it perfectly. If you write books about it, the reason in my parenting books, I write the bloopers I've made, you know, my kids are like shocked by it. Like, how can you show the world what a jerk you can be? Because I said, look, there's no such thing as perfect parenting. Even if you study this stuff, teach about it, write about it, there's no way. We're human. That's what that means. We're human. So the issue that Ed Tronick beautifully writes about is repair. Repair, repair, repair. So we want to take a deep breath and say, well, what's the general strategy? As Louis Pasteur say, how can I have a prepared mind? Louis Pasteur, the scientist, said, chance favors a prepared mind. We want to prepare your mind, even in this brief overview, to say, okay, what direction do I want to bring to my parenting, even though I know, of course, I'm going to mess up. And then I make a repair and a repair and a repair. And that's fine. In fact, resilience is built into children when things haven't gone well, and you don't have to do that on purpose, it'll happen. And then a repair is made so the child realizes, oh, my caregiver is a human being who said, you know something, I was really short with you, or I really got angry at you. That may have been scary for you. Let's talk about what you felt. And I'm going to try not to do that because I've got to work on my own issues. And I'm going to really try not to do that again. That's much better than saying, oh, my child is too young to remember this, so I'm going to ignore it. You know, and no, the brain is remembering things even before birth in something called implicit memory. We won't get into that here, but it's soaking in experience into the structure of the brain. So that's the first thing to say. The second thing to say about your question is, for professionals who are going into a field of helping people, you know, many of us have had adversity. It's just the truth. If you do a survey of mental health professionals, even medical professionals. Now, that isn't to say that, you know, that's really weird. No, actually, it can be a real source of resilience and compassion and understanding. So as Leonard Cohen, the wonderful poet and songwriter, said, you know, and I won't say it as poetically as Cohen did, but it's something like, you know, something like, don't worry about the cracks in the bell. That's where the light comes in, you know, so that the cracks in our own developmental experience that broke us in certain ways and we get ourselves back up enough to go become a professional, you can use that to let the light in, the light of love, really. The light to know there's no such thing as perfection. There's just a direction of love that really has to do with integration.
You, in your writing, have talked about the developments in the adolescent brain. And I wondered if you could talk briefly about that, because I do think that sometimes it's easy for people to think, oh, well, you know, they're teenagers now. They are what they are. Let's think about the next generation, you know, who are in their early years.
Yeah.
You've written about the idea that actually it's never too late. And the way that the adolescent brain is changing, we can get in there and help make some amazing changes.
Well, Laura, that's such a fabulous point. You know, there are, just to start with the myth part of it, there are so many myths out in the parenting world in the modern culture we live in. You know, adolescence is a terrible time and they're done growing and, oh my God, they're going to disconnect from all adults and things like this. Well, the opposite of many of those things is actually the deeper truth, that the brain is not stopping in its growth. It's doing a different thing. It's called remodeling. Instead of just accumulating new connections among the basic cells of the brain, the neurons, it's actually going to take some of those connections and start whittling them away in something called pruning. And then once it prunes down the ones it doesn't think it needs, and it's a use it or lose it principle, then it's going to increase the connectivity among the remaining ones. So if you notice, embedded in that remodeling of pruning and then laying down myelin, which is increasing connectivity, it's basically becoming more integrated. Differentiation is the pruning, and myelination is laying down this sheath around the connected neurons, is linking. So basically the goal, the reason for adolescent remodeling, is to make a more integrated brain.
I'm going to ask my last question, which is, if all the most important change makers in the world were sat watching this, what would you want them to go and do? What are the three things you would want them to go and do to try and help children grow up in safe and loving environments for all the reasons we've discussed?
Well, if you're talking about the world leaders, then I would invite them in their leadership of their organizations or leadership of their countries to have three things come together. The public health world, especially mental health world, with the education world, with the parenting world. You know, it's harder to get a driver's license than it is to actually give birth to a kid, in the sense of, you know, the preparation you have. So we need a department of parenting, you know, in our world, because these communities we started with, they've been so spread out or dissolved and disintegrated. We need to rebuild that. Parenting support communities built on science that goes across cultures. So parenting, education, and health should be combined into one overarching program. And what I would say, and you know, we have this moment now in history with this disruption, is let's start again. You know, it's never too late. Pandemics come every now and then, and okay, we've had one as a whole globe. So let's now work together in this incredible moment of time to create a new way of creating a more integrated world. And what does that really mean? Integration made visible. It's, yes, the love we've been talking about. And how does that manifest itself? As kindness and compassion. And that's what I think we can do, not just with the leaders that are the formal leaders, but with something called pervasive leadership, that anyone listening to this, every one of you, is capable of having the knowledge and learning the skills to then bring out into your life, whether it's just in the skin-encased body called you, or in this larger you that's a we, of people in your family, in your community, in your country, on the whole planet. And I like to remember this by thinking of the term, you know, identity and belonging, those terms. What would it mean to integrate those? Well, you have an inner me, you have a relational we, and you don't have to give up one for the other. So how do you combine them? And in English, we have the fun term we, M-W-E. And so that's, I think, one way for all of us with pervasive leadership to take on the idea that instead of living the isolated solo self, whether it's a solo family or a solo individual, that has been, it has been the teaching of modern culture, the separation, to realize the reality of interconnection. And I like to use the word intra-connection, that there's a connection within this larger whole, that when you take on the mui of, I have an inner as a me, I have a relational as a we, and mui can make this a more compassionate, kinder, more loving world for everyone now and for generations to come.
Thank you so much, Dan, for your knowledge, experience, articulation ability, that's not a phrase, and also your wisdom. I really hope that those watching will literally have their minds changed by what you've said.
Laura, thank you so much. It's an honor to be here with you, to be walking this time with you through these incredible ideas. And be well, and together we can make this a kinder, more compassionate place for all of us to live. So thank you so much.
And thank you for watching. I hope you've enjoyed these conversations and learned from them. I know I have. And while this is the end of this series, please stay tuned for more on the importance of love in childhood coming soon.